has a live chat with Jed Mercurio, the writer of Invasion Earth, on Monday at 1 p.m. at www.beeb.com.
Saturday night gets off to a cracking start on BBC One with Jim Davidson in Big Break at 6:05.
It's a sleazy story about Christy Follicks.
Fraser has his doubts about his partner in Due South.
You know, I don't mean to be critical, but her aim is appalling. I'm a good shot. I just need my glass light out here.
Get aboard with Anthea and Patrick for the National Lottery Big Ticket and hear the numbers called out for the weekend draw. Plus, music from Delamitri. Confrontation in City Central.
Coffee's left down.
There's a crisis of confidence for Amanda Burton.
Or I'm not sure I can do this anymore.
In Silent Witness.
Look at you. You're judging me.
Concluding after the news. That's Saturday night here on BBC One.
Steamy suspense in 40 minutes, a who's doing it. Kinky callers to a chat line, dial M for murder. In our Friday film, listen.
It's the moment we've all been waiting for. Fill up your fridge, plump up your cushions, and light the blue touch paper. The opening ceremony of France 98 and Brazil. Versus Scotland.
It fell so nicely for him, and not for Jim Leighton. Oh, believe it! Oh, and a chance on the far flank!
The World Cup experience kicks off Wednesday afternoon on BBC One and Radio 5 Live.
And now on BBC One, discarding the sheepskin but staying fully clothed for one night only, the full Motty.
The biggest global sporting event of all time is upon us. The eyes of the nation are focused relentlessly on one man. His shoulders carry the expectant weight of millions. Not Shearer, not Huddle, the wolf in sheepskin clothing, John Motson! What a splendid scene. Side by side, celebrity fans of England and Scotland, Arsenal and Spurs, United and City, Liverpool and Everton, brought together by a common desire to put you, Motty, on the spot.
Thanks a lot, Jim.
Now, this lot have spent weeks plotting their own ultimate football challenge for you. You've developed a legendary knowledge through those hundreds and hundreds of games, and they want to put you to the test and make sure you're in top form in France.
Well, certainly I think Glenn Hoddle's got the easier job, to be honest.
To start with, just a very simple question, how many World Cups is it you've actually commentated on?
Oh, let's think. 1974, I nearly forgot. Seven it is now.
Well, that's not a bad start, really. You've got one right. Marvellous. Well, let's relive some of those magical World Cup moments with Motty. And chipped in. Coming through from right back. And Neary! Tremendous goal for the Scots by David Neary.
Here's Socrates pushing the ball forward to Zeka. Oh, what a turn. He threw Gentile. Socrates is in here. It's there! Socrates scores a goal that sums up the philosophy of Brazilian football.
Couldn't find a bigger personality to kick off the questions than Jack Charlton.
How will England do when we get to the World Cup final on the 12th of July?
Well, that's a big assumption, Jack, but I've got to tell you to start with, England have never won a match on the 12th of July. But further to that, seeing you here tonight made me remember that in 1970, I think you were one of the reserves in the stand when we lost to Germany in the quarter-final. Do you remember in Mexico?
Yes.
In fact, somebody told me you were so nervous you walked out before the end.
I went and sat in a coffee bar up the road.
Well remembered. I knew I couldn't be wrong about that. Now, that match was played in a place called León in Mexico. Now, the problem with the World Cup in France is that because of the way the draw is structured, England and Germany could meet in the quarter-final again. It's quite possible. And do you know where that would be played?
In Lyon.
Lyon. It's too close to Lyon, isn't it? Do you know what I mean? I've got this horrible feeling we're going to lose 3-2 in extra time, Jack.
No, John.
Who's going to win it?
My money's on Norway, Jim. I want to see a team from the English Premier League win it.
Do pub landlords get a bit edgy when they see you lurking around the trivia machines? Because for you, it's a bit like a cash point.
Well, the problem with that, Johnny, is that it's my voice on the trivia machine. Uh-huh. But I have been thrown out of a few pubs, but not for that reason.
Well, look, listen, I've got three killers for you from a pub trivia machine. They're going to get harder as we go along. You ready?
I'm ready.
First one's quite easy. You can perhaps all join in. Which dog found the stolen World Cup in 66?
I think that was Pickles.
It's absolutely the correct answer.
Might need some help here.
That's just to limber you up. Okay. Which England player was actually booked in the 66 final?
Booked in the 66 final?
Yep.
Because I nearly said Jack, but I think he was booked with his brother in the quarter-final, weren't you, Jack? It wasn't you in the final, mate, was it?
No.
I think being a man, Johnny, as I am, 10 years behind my time, I think it was the fella that was 10 years ahead of his time, Martin Peters.
You're exactly right. Ungentlemanly conduct.
Oh, really?
Okay, here's the next one. True or false? Castro played in the World Cup final.
It wouldn't be Fidel Castro, would it?
Well, you make your choice. True or false?
Well, I think it's true, because you wouldn't have come up with a name like that unless there'd been a player called Castro who played in the World Cup.
Okay, you're absolutely right, but can you tell me who and why?
Well, I would imagine that you're going back a long time here, because it hasn't been while I've been doing the World Cup, but I would think that what's happened here is you've been reading the record books and you've found a player, and I'm guessing here, that played in the first World Cup final. And I think...
Maybe.
And he either played... That means he could only have played for one or two countries, Uruguay or Argentina.
Yeah. OK. You're OK.
Is that close enough?
Yeah.
What else do you want to know?
No, he actually played for Uruguay and he scored
right against
Argentina. But for extra marks, do you know what was distinctive about him? And I'm going to have to press you on this. and in my pub, this would have won you £2.
OK, well, you're... there was a player with one arm.
Yeah, it's him, yeah.
Was that him?
Okay, then. Do you know how he lost that arm?
No, I don't know. Don't press it, Johnny. Leave it there, mate.
He was a carpenter and it was with a power tool.
And I'm not coming to your pub.
Okay.
Now we turn to an Arsenal fan, Ainsley Harriott, who we might say this season has put the icing on your particular cake.
Oh, thank you very much, Jim. Hello, good evening, John.
Hello, Ainsley.
Now, this will really test your powers of observation here. You've heard of Spot the Ball, have you?
Yes, I have, yeah.
Well, this is Spot the Baldy. Yes, there's been a bit of debate about that this season, John, let's just say, eh?
Yeah, I'm now, not going to say any more about that, Ainsley.
Can you identify the hidden Baldy? This is number one, John. Have a look at this.
There's not much to go on, is there? I was going to go on the shirt, but that doesn't give it away, really. I've just got a funny feeling the shape of the face. It might be Gianluca Vialli.
Very good indeed. Round of applause, there, ladies and gentlemen. And let's move on. This is number two, John.
This isn't you, Ainsley, is it, mate?
Oh!
I've got a funny feeling.
No.
You're what you... Hey.
I can understand you thinking that way, John, yes, but no.
I'm just looking at you because it's a little odd, this. There's someone to your right here. There's a trick in this. I can see him. It's Dion Dublin. Yes.
It's nice to know you can tell the difference between a black pudding and a salami. That's what I mean.
He used to get me in the... He's the only person that got me in the players' bar at Manchester United when he was there. So I've reason to remember him.
OK, this is number three, John. This is a baldy from the 40s, apparently, John. A baldy from the 40s.
What, he's in his 40s or he played in the 40s?
Well, he was around in the 40s, let's just say.
Right, ball player in the 40s. Well, I can only remember one ball footballer from the 40s, and that would be the guy that lifted the cup for Manchester United. Am I on the right track?
Ooh,
Johnny Carey?
No. Think more at home, John.
I'm stuck, mate. Yeah, I can't do that one.
Well, that's you. Baby Motty. Baby Motty.
Oh, no. Unbelievable. I don't know where that came from.
Well, Motty, you're a star of Saturday nights. Here's another one from the big ticket. Manchester United supporter he is, Patrick Keelty.
Motty, I spend all my week getting ready on a Saturday night to pull out my six balls. On Saturday, you only have one ball. And so I was wondering how you spend your week before that big event.
Well, strangely enough, that was the same question that my late father used to get asked, and he was a vicar. I used to think he worked one day a week as well.
I thought you were going to tell me six balls.
No, I was going to leave it at two. But what I was going to say to you there was that I've tried very hard to convince people that it's a full-time job, this sports commentary, and I've got away with it for quite a long time. So basically, I spend the rest of the week looking at videos, football videos, that is.
We're just going to turn for a moment to Gary and Michelle Lineker. And with four children, we obviously know how they spend some of their week, but at least a little bit of it. Anyway, yes. Gary, you have some thoughts on
I've
the
got
proper
set record. That's what I've got, John.
Yeah.
I was wondering, John, whether you were always an obsessive, even as a child.
Well, I wouldn't say I was obsessive. My auntie, who lives in Lincolnshire, says that when I used to go to my grandparents' house when I was five or six, obviously everybody used to be on my own in the back garden pretending I was a footballer, you know, and in those days there weren't sort of spin dryers and things, they'd hang the washing on the line. I suppose they still do some places. And the clothesline was the crossbar, you know, and the two posts that held it up were the goalposts. And the garden shed was the manager's office. And those little garden gnomes on the rockery was like the crowd behind the goal. So that was my sort of imagination when I was five or six. So obsessive, I wouldn't say so.
We've got some clips here that show where you end up if you spend too much time looking at football handbooks.
Certainly some football history being made here. I'm sure the penalty spot has never been painted during a first division match before. And how fitting that a man called Buchan should be the first to climb the 39 steps that lead from the pitch here at Wembley to the Royal Box.
Yes, John, perhaps if you could cut down on the facts and concentrate on the game itself.
Well, curiously enough, Des, that's the seventh time you've said that to me this season.
Referee Gerald Ashby of Worcester showed the red card to Carlton Palmer of Sheffield Wednesday when he was last here, and it's 17 years to the day since red and yellow cards were first used in our domestic football.
Yes, and as I say, John, you do seem to be giving us rather too many facts.
Yes, well, curiously enough, that was only my second fact of the match, which compares to 396 facts of the match against Turkey.
The first hat-trick in an FA Cup semi-final since 1958 hasn't been done since Alex Dawson did it for Manchester United against a Fulham team that included Jimmy Hill.
All right, that's it.
Curiously enough, back to you, Des.
Alistair McGowan, you used to do Motty on Spitting Image. Why do impressionists pick on him, do you think, particularly?
Well, as you ask, Tim, and as you know yourself, you know, I think the important thing is that John does have a voice that people recognise, which is obviously a very important part of what I do. No, seriously, I remember, now you ask, I remember Trevor Brooking once saying, well, I think the thing about Motty, you know, is that he's a legend, really, isn't he? And Alan Hansen once said, the thing about Motty, he's an institution. And as Gary Lineker once said, well, the thing about Motty is that he's a legend who should be in an institution.
We move across London to Bradley Walsh, an Arsenal fan, whose team has had a spectacular season.
Thanks. yeah, I don't actually own the team, but I know what you mean. John, how are you, mate?
All right, Bradley, you?
Yeah, nice to see you, mate. As this is called the full Motty, I just wondered, and probably some of the girls are wondering, if you are going to take your kit off at the end of the gig.
What, afterwards, you mean?
Well, you could probably dance with Jim, because he's got a great sense of rhythm. It's a wonder he hasn't got 50 kids. Having said that, I want to ask you a quick question about the 1966 World Cup final squad. Now, a lot of people will know this question, and probably Jackie doesn't even know either. There was a player in the 1966 squad whose sister had a number one hit with a pop record in England. Can you name that player and the sister, just quickly? Can you think of that?
No, I can't.
Well, it was Jimmy Greaves and his sister, Frieda.
Good evening, Robin.
Good evening, Davina.
Hello, let's talk music.
Right.
Now, you were once quoted as saying that your musical appreciation started and finished with the New Seekers. Is that true?
That was said by Chris Waddle about me. And I'll tell you how that happened. We were in Detroit in the 1994 World Cup, and as you know, Davina, Detroit is the home of Tamla Motown.
Yeah.
And
hit me.
Well, the record on the radio wasn't actually Tamla Motown. It was Saturday Night by Wigfield, and I'd never heard of Wigfield. And Chris Waddle.
Yeah.
Okay. So Chris Waddle said to me, "Well, it's quite clear," he said, "that your pop music knowledge started with Elvis and ended with the New Seekers," and that was the thing I've had to live with since then.
So who's your favourite band now, then?
The Who, I think.
That's okay, that's good.
Is that okay?
That works, that
Fine.
Works.
Good.
So we thought we'd test your musical knowledge, Joe and I. And we've got here a group of England players, and they are singing a song. Now, we've put some fake music over the top.
Right.
And I want you to tell me what the original song was.
Okay. Talking about Waddle, that was coming up, by the way. So I've got to do it in reverse now, because that's it. Chris Waddle and Glenn Hoddle, Diamond Lights.
Yeah.
The middle one was John Barnes.
Yeah.
And it was a Liverpool record, cup final record, the Anfield rap.
Doing well.
And I don't like rap music, use it. And the first one was obviously Gazza, and I think he's singing with Lindisfarne, isn't he?
Yeah.
In which means, is it Fog on the Time?
That's absolutely it. Welcome.
Thank you for the guest, that last one.
move on now back to Alistair McGowan.
Well, actually, it's Joe Brand. And, thank you. I've got a challenge to warm the cockles of your heart, John. It's called Get Your Kit On for the Lads. Can you identify these strips?
I'm too sexy for my shirt.
Please welcome real-life Fulham fan Nicky Diamond. Bit of a double diamond there. Motty Totty number two is Chelsea supporter Sam Coles. And lovely Kathy Lloyd is number three. She is a Liverpool fan. Number four, Katie Richmond, is a Red Devil for Man United, but not in that shirt. Number five, Arsenal supporter Joe Guest, who could turn many a chap's eye in that outfit. And David Mennelly's little introduction, as you can tell. So, whose are those strips, John?
The first one, there's just one that caught my eye straight away, because there's bound to be a catch in this, but we'll come to that in a minute. That is an away strip worn, I think, by... Jimmy, you should know this with your background. I think that's Fulham's away strip. Now, because it's you, I know there's obviously a Scottish connection here somewhere. And I think it's here. This lady here, I think, is Miss Partick Thistle, the Jags.
You may be right.
I don't think these are all club strips, are there? There's some international teams here, aren't there?
No clues, John, no clues.
Well, it's World Cup year, and I've just seen a little emblem here. Not my picture on, no, on the other side. don't. you didn't hear that. This is South Africa, yeah?
It is indeed South Africa, yes, there it is.
And if we're going well down the World Cup road, and I'm thinking quickly here because I'm still not sure about one up there. I think there's another World Cup shirt here. I think that design here on the lady's green shirt, I think that's the Reggae Boys. I think that's Jamaica.
Four out of six.
I'll come to you in a minute. on second thoughts, am I? Well, I'm going to go down the same road, because if we've got South Africa and Jamaica, there's got to be a third team in the World Cup for the first time. I'm trying to think the way this has been set up. Japan. Lucky there. That was a guess, actually. That was a guess. And finally, well, the David Mellor look-alike. Obviously, Chelsea. We'd have preferred it if you'd sent along... you know, the actress or something like that. But it is done. Your name is obviously not David Mellor. What's your real name?
Ivan Shakespeare.
Ivan Shakespeare?
Ivan Shakespeare.
As you like it. all I can say is you're in extremely good and attractive company, Mr. Shakespeare. Thank you very much.
You're looking a little flushed after all that excitement.
A bit tense, that one, Jim.
Well, let's have a question from Chelsea supporter Clive Mantle.
Good evening, John. As a former TV doctor, obviously very concerned with the nation's health, and I wondered, are TV pundits and experts and commentators good physical specimens, good role models?
The worst experience I've had in terms of health was, not many people know that I've got a plate at the top of my mouth with two false teeth on. And in the 1986 World Cup in Mexico, Jimmy and I were together doing a match, and there was a freak electric storm came over the stadium. All the commentators' notes got blown away off the desks. Everybody lost their files and their program and their team charts and everything. And in my despair, trying to sort of catch the notes and also utter a few words over what was happening on the pitch, I actually lost this plate, flew out my mouth. My teeth ended up on the desk of the Peruvian commentator, two rows in front. which Jimmy found quite hilarious, but fortunately he gave them back to me, which was really kind of him.
Thank you. Now to Dion Dublin.
Evening, John. My question is, you've talked about football for years and years and years, and I want to know, was you any good at football yourself? Or was you sort of last pick when it came to a five-a-side?
I wasn't even picked for any of the five-a-sides, but when I was on the local weekly paper in the 60s, because I couldn't get a game anywhere else, I had to form my own team with a few friends who were working on the local paper with me, and we formed a club in the Barnet Sunday League called Roving Reporters. That was called that because there was no ground and we were all journalists. 33 years on, the club still exists, and they've just won promotion, and there's a few of the lads here tonight in the audience from Roving Reporters in the Barnet Sunday League.
I have a little bit of a surprise, John, because the Roving Reporters have got together with a gentleman called Garth Crooks, who you know only too well, to look back at the playing career of John Motson.
1966, Bobby Moore lifts the Jules Rimet Trophy. While the same year, an ambitious young John Motson catches the eye in a charity game. Since then, 30 years of dedication and hurt never stopped John Motson dreaming. Just look at him here. Beaten once, the wily old ferret comes back for more. He's never satisfied. The promising youngster became the flair player of the 70s. No surprise was that successive England managers resisted calls for a cap, forcing him to audition for a part in The Professionals. Earned the nickname Chopper, for reasons we can't legally mention. He's simply the governor for his love of the boozer. But to most of us, he's plain old Motty, because it's short for Motson. Bloody obvious, really. John Motson, we salute you.
As the match official, I think Motty should take a half-time breather now, and while he sucks on his orange, I'm handing over to Craig Charles, who had trials for Tranmere and played for Liverpool Boys.
All this talk of Hodden squad, mystics and spoon benders, the only guy I think is God is the guy we're going to send you, is John Motson for the World Cup final. David Seaman's number one, his hands are safe and clean. The only way to make him glum is to mention that Naeem. Graeme LeSeau will surely go. He must be worth a mensch, because he's the only one with tickets, because his name sounds bloody French. John Motson for the World Cup final. Gazza, if he's fit, he'll play. He won't go on the town. He wouldn't want to anyway. The French hate Nuki Brown. John Motson for the World Cup final. Michael Owen's the one for me. His youth cannot be knocked, because Grandad Fowler's 23. And unfortunately, he's crocked. Alan Shearer, he got the call because of poise and power and pace. And what you'll hear from the stands and the stalls is you've never ever seen a better booter of a football. John Motson for the World Cup final. So do your shop in early June and get your money spent, and then for one whole month sit down and watch the tournament. It really will be spectacular. I'm sure it won't be grotty. And if England get knocked out in round one, well, at least we'll have the full Motty! John Motson for the World Cup final.
Well done, Craig.
Well, we've met one England World Cup winner tonight, and now welcome to another member of that unforgettable team and the only man to score a hat-trick in a World Cup final. That's Geoff Hurst. Good evening, Motty.
Good evening, Jeff. I like those two inside forwards you've got either side of you tonight.
Well, you can see the reason they're here, because I have with me this magnificent trophy, yes, which I'm simply minding for Alan Shearer for the moment. Oh. We're going to show you some of the sport's most coveted trophies, which are about to appear before you. Can you recognise them?
Oh. Isn't that the old Milk Cup that was awarded a few years ago for our League Cup? That's the FA Cup. Well, obviously, I should get that. The next one... I'm not sure about that. I think that's a Scottish trophy, but I don't know which one it is. And that one there, I haven't got a clue.
Well, it's the only sports trophy that you ever won. It's the 1966 Barnett and Potter's Bar Youth Table Tennis
Table
Championship.
Tennis.
Now, as we can obviously see, you fancy yourself as a bit of a sporting all-rounder. I know you've done a bit of running in your time as well. Have you ever fancied commentating on another sport?
Well, in my early days in radio, Steve, it's probably too long ago for people to remember now, I did do some boxing and some tennis commentary. I did the Wimbledon Championships for radio for 5 or 6 years, and the last year I was there, I was commentating on one of the outside courts, where it's very difficult to get a good view, but I did a little sort of eerie commentary box, and there was a spiral staircase leading up to it. Heavy security, and one of the security people knocked on the door and said, could we let a chap called Jack Nicholson in? Because this Mr. Nicholson knew one of the players who was taking part in the game. Well, of course, I turned around and it was the man himself. And he came in and sat next to me, and I told the producer that we'd got Jack Nicholson in the commentary box. And he said, well, bring him in, let him, you know, have a chat about what he thinks about tennis and so on, which we did. It was great. And then Jack Nicholson made the mistake, well, he didn't know it was a mistake, but he picked up the headphones that I was supposed to be wearing. And so all the instructions the producer was trying to give me went to Jack Nicholson. And halfway through, we were getting on fine with the chat and everything, but we'd lost complete touch with where they were with the game, who was winning. And halfway through the next set, the producer apparently screamed and said, we don't even know what the score is here. And Jack Nicholson obviously took this in and turned to me and said, give him the score, Johnny.
Jim Tarbuck, really, a master in his own profession, but you may not know, he very nearly became a professional footballer himself.
Jim. A bit like yourself, Jim. Yes. You set him off, Jim, I'll whack him. How are you, Motty?
All right, Jim, yeah, fine.
Well, you can see how we all love you, because all the lads are here, Lynchy and Adam Faith and me, because we think the world of you. I've watched you, and you are a true, great professional at your job.
Here, here. Thank you.
But like all true great professionals, you must have made a few rickets in your time, a few dash-its and blow-its. And I want to know, is there any one line you regret saying?
Yeah, there is. It wasn't actually a football commentary. It was in the Montreal Olympics when I got sent to do the Greco-Roman wrestling. This was 1976, and it was quite a big year for me. I got married, and I covered the Greco-Roman wrestling at the Olympic Games. And they sent me there 5 days running, and for the first 4 days, they never used a foot of it, not surprisingly. Then on the fifth day, there was a downpour at the equestrian centre, and so they had to fill up quickly with something else, and they said, we're going to come live to the Greco-Roman wrestling. And I picked up with a bout between a Russian and a Bulgarian. Went through the whole thing, 3 rounds, declared the winner, end of story. And then I suddenly realised that all through this bout, I'd got the two wrestlers the wrong way round. But I remember that year, Jim, because I remember doing an interview with you that year. Liverpool, I think, had just won a couple of trophies under Bob Paisley. And I came to interview you before a Merseyside derby. Mm-hmm. And I said to you, what do you think the score's going to be on Saturday? And you said, I think it'll be 3 each. And I said, what, you rate Everton that highly? And you said, no, no, 3 for Keegan, 3 for Toshack, and 3 for Holland.
Well, it's like being in the confessional, really, here, because my worst experiences on
television... Oh, listen, I was going to say, you must have had a couple of slip-ups.
Well, more than... I've got it right 1 week, I thought, but anyway... when I introduced Nigel Starmer-Smith, three names, quite difficult. I'd never heard of him before, but he was some kind of rugby commentator. And I said, and now we go over to join Nigel Starmer-Smith, who's had seven craps as a scum half for England. Well, everybody has got their favourites. Here's Motson. And here's a selection of five one-liners, which you might afterwards prefer to forget.
Well, early on, Liverpool were strolling, and they had United rolling. But when United had to convince, they produced a goal from Paul Ince. Carlson at the back, number three, outstanding. Absolutely safe as a rock there. Looks a little bit like Noddy Holder out of Slade, doesn't he? Vidal, its very name has a magic ring to it, and from the fairy tale land of Denmark, they've come up here with a little goal scoring gnome called Ronnie Eklund. For anybody watching in black and white, Spurs are playing in all yellow today.
From the original Crazy Gang, a player I'd always have on my side, Vinnie Jones.
How are you, Jimmy?
All right, Vinnie.
Being from Wales, as you know, I think the audience and the people at home would like to know what really makes a good sheepy, John.
Well, the reason I first got connected with the sheepskin coat was I was at Wickham for a cup match one December, and it was a lovely sunny day all round, and then the snow came down, a very localised storm, and suddenly the pitch was covered 4 inches of snow, and I had to go and do a report to grandstand to say why this game was off. And I was wearing the sheepskin coat, and you know, people could see the snow coming down, and I was looking a bit of an idiot really, and somebody took a photograph of it, and it got made into a postcard. And ever since then, the sheepskin coat and I have been inseparable, really. I mean, I don't go to bed in it or anything, but I do wear it quite a lot.
Well, we've actually got that famous piece of archive footage of you in the snow at Wickham here for you to see.
Right, shall we go to Motty now then, lads?
No, I'll even just suffer a bit.
OK. Let's see where I am. I'm
just going to put my sandwiches in here, don't Motty? All right. He sure wants to sort that bit out of the front there.
I know, I think the sheep's still alive.
I've just noticed he's got no gloves on. That's just asking for trouble. There's no protection.
Yeah, that's not a good thing, is that?
Leaves his hands wide open.
Mm-hmm. Look, we'd better go over now, lads. Fun's over. I mean, a joke's a joke and all that, but he's looking a bit blue, isn't he, really?
Oh, no, I'll leave it a bit longer. I'm enjoying this.
Well, that's right, and if he always will be so punctual, what's he expect? Well, that's right, lads. I mean, he's been there since 7 this morning, hasn't he, waiting for this one?
That's dedication for you.
Yeah, that's Motty for you.
Yeah, that snow, I can't imagine they're playing that, but they'll need a gritter before long, I suppose. Maybe one of those inflatable balloons like the one at Leicester City several years ago.
Yeah, OK, well, thanks, Trev, for that, yeah.
I mean, yes, but Arsenal, if you think about it, they had undersold heating.
All right,
and all
Trevor, thanks very much.
Yeah, OK, lads, now, cue Motty, come on. Let him go, come on, cue him, cue him.
Must have asked in his ear. So there he goes. Well, I'm very pleased you've finally come to me here, Desmond, because needless to say, it is a bit parky out here. Starting to get a bit of frostbite in my extremities, actually, but at least I now have some idea of how Sherpa Tenzing must have felt in 1953, of course, when he climbed Everest. But he, of course, would have had a lot of protective clothing on. All I've got, of course, is this sheepskin jacket, and I'm not actually wearing any trousers either, or any shoes. I'm wearing the weather forecasters. They said it's going to be sunny. Bloody Suzanne Chopin, what does she know?
Motty, come over and join me. For all the entertainment you've given us through the years, we're going to pay tribute in song. The musicians look like they're ready, so please welcome Motty the Hoople.
Motson, that's our way.
away. Football nutters all agree. He's a football buff of note, with fingers all down to his sheepskin coat. Ask him any match what was the score, he'll tell you, and what socks they wore. Motty Motson's got the knack, he's some football anorak.
Spurs this year come very near to almost going down, while Arsenal were playing football like Spurs were once renowned.
But when Motty's got a commentator spot, he does just what he ought to. We all know and don't it show, he's a Spurs supporter. Motty Motson, nuts are we, football nutters all agree. He's a football buff of note, with fingers all down to his sheepskin coat. Ask him any match what was the score, he'll tell you, and what socks they wore. Motty Motson's got the knack, he's some football anorak.
Come on, Billy. Go on, Billy.
Here we go.
Now all us lot think he's got the lot when it comes to the game.
Yeah.
He's a wonderful man, and that man can name any footballer's name.
Yeah.
But sometimes he slips up the sea, but it proves he's a genuine fella.
For the benefit of those watching in black and white, Spurs are playing in yellow.
Motty Motson, not we. He's a football buff of note, with fingers all down to his sheepskin coat. Ask him any match what was the score, he'll tell you, and what socks they wore. Motty Motson's got the knack, he's a football anorak. Motty Motson's got the knack, he's a football, he's a football, he's a football anorak.
The boy is back in town. EastEnders on BBC One.
Did England manage another solid day between the stumps? Today's play at Edgbaston on BBC Two in 10 minutes.
His goal of 100 tickets is a purely personal challenge.
How many people am I going to nick tomorrow?
If I want to get my 100, I've got to average about 10 an hour.
How many jobs offer continual satisfaction?
I hope it rains heavy, so people don't expect me to be still working.
In Labour? Well, I'll still give it a ticket.
And lively debate with the general public.
And I tell you, already you are the worst.
The Clampers in your neighbourhood, Monday at 9:30 and Tuesday on BBC One.
Prowling the dimly lit streets for fresh corpses to sell, Peter Cushing and Donald Pleasance in a macabre trade at 12:35. Erotic fantasies and sexual desires lead to murder first on BBC One. Here is The Friday Night Killer Chiller.